Welcome to See Me for Life's iPanry study resource. Our whole goal is to prepare you for the Panry content of 2019, be it the alternative Panry or if you're doing the high stake exam. Our focus is on core content and teaching the different levels that you need to learn content at for the 2019 curriculum. Welcome to See Me for Life's iPanry. My name is John Belinsky. I'm a PA. I've been a PA for 21 years. This is probably the 70th time I've put on this course, and I'm called to it. Everybody's a genius, but if you judge a fish by its ability to climb a tree, it will live its whole life thinking it's stupid. Ladies and gentlemen, that's my story, okay? My story is I didn't graduate high school on time because my grades were so bad. I went through my high school career, my junior high school career, as the guy who didn't get it. I was in special classes for people learning disabilities. And my experience was, it sucked. It really affected my self-esteem. I don't read well. I flip around letters. Okay, I'll try to read something and I won't understand what I just read. And it made me feel very inadequate in high school. Okay, that's my story. But it didn't make sense because I could play chess well, I could read people well, I could hear a song two times that I know all the lyrics. Just why couldn't I do well in a traditional academic setting? It became very affecting my identity, okay? I don't know if any of you guys ever felt that way. If you're here in PA school, you're probably pretty sharp, but there's probably a part of you that can identify with what I'm saying at some level. Probably. I learned how to learn in the Marine Corps. So I got out of high school. I went in the Marines for 4 years. And I learned how to learn in the Marines because I was with a combat unit in Desert Storm, and we were frontline unit, and I'm looking at bad guys, and my job as a dragon gunner was to blow up enemy tanks. And guys, it wasn't like we weren't engaged. We were right there. I'm watching people get killed. So all of a sudden, my job was to blow up an enemy tank. And there were so many vehicles in the Desert Storm because so many countries were involved. It wasn't as simple as, oh, that's a bad tank, that's a good tank. It was, wait a second, which country is that from and are they on our team or not? So we had to learn all these vehicles, right? So they gave us a stack of playing cards, flashcards, if you will, 60 of them. And I'd flip through them and go, wait, this is a good one, bad one, oh, this armored vehicle, okay, fine. I flipped through those cards two or three times and I knew it like the back of my hand. And all of a sudden I realized we all learn a little bit different, okay? I can say something here and she gets it. She's so good at it. She hears it, sees it, she owns it. She can get 100 on the test and she can take the clinical practice. But my friend here, it doesn't work for him. He's got to see a patient with CHF. I can talk about CHF all day. He's like fuzzy until he sees one. And then he owns it, okay? You might have a different learning style. We all have slightly different learning styles, okay? We're all geniuses if I can teach to your learning style. Ladies and gentlemen, the IQ test was not designed to see who was brilliant. The IQ test, invented in France by a guy named Binet, was designed to see who just needs eight traditional teaching techniques. I realized as an instructor, one way to teach doesn't fit all. I want to be an awesome instructor, whether it's here in a classroom or on rotations. But I understand that if I have her as a student and I pimp her, it shuts her down. She can't learn if I pimp her. She becomes so paralyzed that that's not an effective teaching strategy for her. So guess what? I don't want to shut her down, so I don't pimp her as hard. She might need to be pimped. Well, you might need to be pimped. And if I pimp you mercilessly, it just drives you harder. We all learn a little bit different. And as I look at what's my why? Why do I do this? I'll tell you exactly why I do this. What's my passion for teaching? It truly is to ignite your passion and enthusiasm. That's what my goal is over the next 3 days, is to ignite your passion and enthusiasm in people so they can create extraordinary lives. That's why I do what I do. Medicine is awesome, guys. My experiences, the better I got at medicine, the more I liked it. The more value I brought to my boss. Now, Malcolm Gladwell, he's really a profound thinker, and I'm really into thinking. He wrote a book called Blink, and he said, we've come to confuse information with understanding. Guys, what do you want out of this course, and what am I supposed to do over the next couple days? You could say, well, John, I want information. I'm going to say, no, you don't want information. You're overwhelmed with information. If you want information, open up this book and go to the library. I can't give you this much information. It's impossible. You don't want information. You're overwhelmed with it. They call that information blindness. You want to get it. My job over the next 3 days is to help you to get it. Deeply get it. So that when a question's in front of you or patient's in front of you, you're like, I have the answers. Ladies and gentlemen, I cannot tell you how rewarding it is when someone's sick and you know what's going on and you know what needs to be done to make them better. When you can look in a patient's eyes and say, I got this and I'm gonna help you fix this. It's awesome. I got a confession for you. This slide here, I stole it from another Board of View course. I did. I stole it from another Board of View course, and I could read this information to you, and it's good information. Everything about that is accurate. I almost think that's insulting. Like, I'm not here to read you slides. Go read a book. I won't do this. My job is to be an educator, to teach you, to make you understand it. Let me give you an example of what that means to me as an instructor over the next 3 days is, you guys know that menopause, if you want to know if a woman's in menopause, you want to check an FSH level. Because if their ovaries shut down, their pituitary is going to go, hey, wake up, wake up, wake up. It's going to jack up FSH levels. So you have to know that. That's important. That'll be probably a board question. Now, if I just show you this, it embraces your left brain. It's analytical. Okay, we all learn a little bit different. I look at this and go, hey, maybe you can remember it. Maybe you're that smart, you know anatomy, physiology, and you just get it. For me, I struggle with that, so I always come up with ways to make you remember so you can't forget. Now, I love to fish. I fish all the time. I fish as often as I can. Okay, I'll fish fly fishing, I'll fish saltwater fishing, bass. I just love to fish, right? Now, where I used to work for 9 years in Westfield, New York, I would drive home and I'd always go over a bridge, and under that bridge was a trout stream. And every time I drive over the bridge, I'd pause, I'd slow down my car a little bit, and I'd look over the side to see if there was a bunch of guys fishing the bank. Because if I see a bunch of guys fishing the bank, it means there's got to be a lot of fish that they're fishing for. There's got to be. So I'd pause and slow down to see if there's a bunch of fishermen, because I know that that means there's a lot of people fishing, right? And if you're a guy like me who fishes, like if you're a real hardcore fisherman, you'd pause too. So what am I saying? I'm saying that a bunch of men are going to pause to see if there's a lot of fishermen, because a lot of fishermen, there's a lot of fish. So what am I saying? I'm saying that men will pause if there's a lot of fish. So I'm saying that if you want to know if a woman's in menopause, you check an FSH level. Menopause, fish. This is how to embrace your right brain so you can't forget it if you want to. Menopause is heralded by a high FSH level. Those are the insights that I hope to provide to you over the next 3 days. Now, I taught for PA schools at PA schools for 12 years in Buffalo, New York. I taught lab medicine, EKG, and radiology. And if you said to me, John, how do I get straight A's in PA school? I would not say to you, master the content. Because I think mastering the content is only about 70% of your grade. That's what I think. I think you have 30% of your grade that has nothing to do with content at all. It has to do with the game. You've got to know how to play the game. So what does that mean, John? It means that if you wanted to get straight A's in PA school, you have to know the tester. You have to know the game. Ladies and gentlemen, there's two systems of learning, a natural system and a social system. Social system is manipulative, and that is your boards. That's academic grades. And you guys know what I'm talking about. You can have a dermatology test, right? And you cram in the test, you get an A in the test, and you're like, woohoo. But then 2 weeks later, you can't identify shingles rash, and you don't know to put them on an antiviral. Okay, so cramming is superficial, it's a social system. Where a natural system, you cannot manipulate. It's like health and fitness, it's like farming, and it's like true learning. You can't manipulate it. Like if you get a job in orthopedics, you are going to get really good at knowing all the bones and all the ligaments and all the tendons because you're taking care of patients. It's a natural system at that point. But right now, you're studying for your boards. So you have to study the game. So I want to introduce you to Pam. You have to know her to understand the game. So she's a fictitious person, but I want you to have an avatar of her. Who is Pam? Pam is a program director. She's a program director of a prestigious college. She's been in that role for 30 years. Why do we have to know about Pam? Because Pam is who writes your test questions. She writes your test questions. She's a test writer for the NCCPA. So we have to think about, what do you think she thinks about? How does she write questions? Let me ask you, you tell me about Pam. First off, let me ask you this question. How many hours a week does she work clinically? What do you think? 12, zero. Any other thoughts? If you're a program director, you cannot know how busy program directors are. But understand, program directors, they have pressure on them that you cannot possibly know about. They're working their ass off just to keep the program healthy. So guess what? Program directors, they ain't pulling shifts. So Pam ain't working at all. Last patient she saw was when she was at a family reunion and Aunt Betsy had a syncopal episode. That's the last patient she saw. And that was 2 years ago. So guess what? She's writing test questions. Where's she getting her questions from? She's getting them from a book. What book is she getting them from? Is she getting them from Harrison's? It's probably not Pants Prep Pearls. It'll be one step above that. It's going to be something like Currents. Okay? It's not a Harrison's. Now, you got to understand something. So when she's getting questions from that book, she's going by demographics like it's gospel. Okay? Demographics are going to be wicked important to know how to play the game. Ladies and gentlemen, you ain't going to have a 55-year-old guy with right upper quadrant pain with biliary colic. Because who gets biliary colic? Fat female 40-year-olds. That's exactly right. So I'm telling you, when they say a 44-year-old female with right upper quadrant pain, you got to go, bah, that's the exact age of biliary colic. It's got to jump into your brain. If I say a 2-year-old that's vomiting, guess what? It ain't pyloric stenosis. Pyloric stenosis happens in 5-week-olds. So demographics, bless you, are going to be a really big part of teaching you how to study for your boards. There's one other thing that you have to know about Pam. And the best way you can know it is by looking in her eyes right now. Look deeply in her eyes right now. Can you see how she seems nice and all, but she's pissed? Look at how pissed off she is. She's trying to be friendly, but you know what she's pissed off about the people in this room? She is pissed off that you want to write for meds too quickly and you want to order expensive tests. And she's sick of it. And if you have that psychology, she's going to make you pay on the boards. She wants you to do what she did 30 years ago, lifestyle modifications, lifestyle modifications, lifestyle. Take the passive path. I will talk about that more in this course. When it comes to the boards, the passive answer is almost always right, unless the sequelae of the disease is catastrophic, but I'm going to coach you through that as this course goes on. When it comes to the NCCVA blueprint, guys, my job right now is to help you understand the game. We got to play the game. So there are 13 categories on the boards, 551 disease states that you have to know. Now, let me explain how you need to know them. I work, guys, my passion is to help those people that are struggling, okay? When did you guys take your PACRAT? The seniors, when did you take your PACRAT? How long ago?
We took it last summer and then again in February.
So you took it a couple months ago? Okay, just so you know, the cutoff of the pack rate is about 150. If you're above 150, you're fine. If you're below 150, you're not fine. And the further away from the 150 mark, the more trouble you're in. Okay? If you're 130s on the pack rate, you are in big trouble. It is predictable. 140s, you're probably okay. If you're 160s, 170s, you can do whatever you want to study for your boards because you're going to pass. It is very predictable about outcomes. So the magic number is 150. Now, how do you know if you know a disease? Because, ladies and gentlemen, a lot of us study a disease and we're familiar with it, but we don't know it. That's got to stop today. You have to know how to test yourself to see if you know it. And you test it with what I call the questions of mastery. Here are the 4 questions you have to ask about every single disease. Number 1 is, what's a pathophysiology? What's wrong? Now, when I say that, I mean, you have to be able to describe it so a patient understands it in small words. You have to know exactly what you're saying, and you got to be able to say it to a patient. So if you can break the pathophysiology down in small words, it means you own the disease. Second thing is, how do they present? You have to know how a patient with this disease process presents. Is it chest pain? Is it shortness of breath? Is it syncope? And then I'm going to tell you, know the second tier presentations. So what's the primary presentation of a heart attack, chest pain? What's secondary presentation? Shortness of breath. You have to know chest pain or shortness of breath, you better think cardiac. Next is, how do I diagnose it? How do I know, yeah, this is what's going on there? Is it by a physical exam? Is it by a diagnostic test? You want to know what's the initial diagnostic test and the definitive diagnostic test. And last one is, how do I treat it? Guys, if you know these 4 questions to every disease, you own it. Dilated cardiomyopathy. Let's start with that one. Now, don't say anything, but think it in your head. If I said to you, you got a patient with a dilated cardiomyopathy, what's the pathophysiology there? Think about it in your head right now. If I said, you got to go to your grandfather calls you and says, oh my gosh, my doctor just said I have a dilated cardiomyopathy. What does that mean? And you got to describe to it what it means. Could you? Now, this is what I would say. I would say, well, pathophysiology is you have a really floppy heart muscle. It's really thinned out and it's not able to pump very effectively. That's why you're sick. How do they present? Well, they present in CHF, and CHF always presents short of breath. Always. So I know that there's no way they can ask a dilated cardiomyopathy question unless they say shortness of breath. It's impossible. How do I diagnose it? Well, there's some physical exam findings of CHF. There's some radiographic findings of CHF. There's some lab findings of CHF. There's some echocardiographic findings of CHF. And then how do I treat it? Okay? You have to know the treatments of CHF. So bottom line is my goal in this course to help you understand these questions. If I said to you Graves' disease, can you answer those questions? If not, you don't know it. So then open the book so you can answer those four questions. And then once you can answer the four questions, you got it. Pyelonephritis. I don't care what disease it is, these are the four questions you have to ask. And guys, once you're able to do it, your confidence goes way up. And if you realize, wait, my therapeutics, I don't know therapeutics for pneumonia. Guess what? Now go open your book. Beautiful. When we learn, we go on this trajectory. It's called the path to competence, where you follow this trajectory. Ladies and gentlemen, right here is what's called unconscious incompetence. That means you don't know what you don't know. That's a toxic place to be in because you don't know what to study. I'm going to tell you how you go from this box to this box. Over here is conscious incompetence. That means you now know where you're weak and you know what you have to study. If you don't know what you don't know, you're going to be spinning your wheels in the snow and not moving anywhere. You're probably going to defer to studying the things that you like because it makes you feel good. But you're wasting your time. This is the beauty of the pack rat. You go from you don't even know what you don't know to at least now I know where I'm weak. Now you know where you have to go to work. So then you go to work. Then hopefully you get to the phase of conscious competence where at least you know it and you can figure it out. Most PA students get there for their boards on EKGs and blood gases. I can figure it out, but don't rush me. I need to work through this process. Over here, this is the unconscious competence where you know it like the back of your hand. You just own it. And ladies and gentlemen, there is stuff that you need to know like the back of your hand. And you know what we did for you? We made it super simple for you. We put them on 750 flashcards. We sent them to you. Okay? Junior class, did you get those? Okay, I am telling you it is the low-hanging fruit. It's the stuff you have to know. You have to know cardiac risk factors in your gut. If they say a diabetic smoker, this guy's a vasculopath. And as soon as they say diabetic smoker, you got to go, this guy's got arterial disease. You got to know it viscerally. This is the stuff that's on, you just got to know viscerally, like in the, I pop it. Now, I just said, how do we go from unconscious incompetence? Well, I said that you could do the pack rat. That's super important. But guys, you can't control that. You don't know when you're taking the pack rat. You can't control the pack rat. The school controls it. So is there any way that you can control this jump? Yes, there is. It's with the NCCPA pretests. This is a secret weapon. If there's only one thing I could tell you to do to help you pass your boards, it's got to be this. Matter of fact, guys, I am absolutely at your service. And when I say that, I mean, if you are struggling, you need to reach out to me because I will help you. Okay? I will personally help you. I will bring you back to another course. I will do whatever I can. I'm a very expensive speaker. Your school pays a lot of money to bring me here. But now that I'm here, I feel a responsibility for you. Okay? Like I want to help you however I can. Now, if you call me and say, John, I'm struggling a little bit, I'm going to say, I need to see your NCCP pretest scores. Let me explain what this is. First off, there are, if you log on to your NCCP account, there are four pretests you have available to you. Two PANSES and two PANRIs. Now, the PANSES is the initial certification exam. The PANRI is the recertification exam. Now, what's the difference between the two? The answer is nothing. So you have, what do you mean nothing? I'm telling you it's nothing. Well, how do you know, John? Well, because I talked to the CEO of the NCCPA. So you have four pretests that you can take. You should think of them as the same. They're testing the same body of information. Each test is 120 questions. You get an hour and 20 minutes to take it, just like the boards, a minute a question. Ladies and gentlemen, they're old board questions. You can't get a better pretest. And they break it down exactly like the boards, where 16% is cardiac, 12% is pulmonary, 10% is musculoskeletal. So you get a mini boards, and then as soon as you take it, you get this printout. Let me explain how valuable this printout. Guys, you have four chances to take that test. Let me explain the value of this. This is my pretest. I took the pretest so I could take a picture of it and show you. When I was recertifying about 3 years ago, I did a pretest. So this was what they gave me as soon as I finished. My top is my overall score. So low is red, yellow, green. This black line is where I scored. They said, John, you're on the low end of high, but you're in the green. Go take your boards. You're ready. Okay? So they're saying, based on my overall score, you're fine. But guys, they give me more information than that. They break down each body system and say, how did I score in each body system? So here's cardiovascular. This vertical line is what the boards think is acceptable knowledge. Here's where I scored. So they're saying, John, you're pretty good on cardiac. Don't worry about studying that. Pulmonary, here's the vertical line. Here's where I scored. John, you're pretty good with your lungs. Don't worry about that. GI, hey, you're pretty good at GI. Don't worry about that. Musculoskeletal, you fall a little bit below where we think is acceptable musculoskeletal. But guys, that makes sense to me because I'm an emergency medicine guy. I'm emergency medicine critical care. That's my training and my background. If someone's shoulder's out, I'll pop it back in. I don't really care about rotator cuff injuries because that's not an emergency medicine problem. I'm going to put them in a shoulder mobilizer, send them to ortho. I really don't care about the queer vein tenosynovitis. That's not an ER complaint. I don't care about that. Go to ortho. Okay? Bottom line is this makes sense to me that I'm a little weak here. Guys, I work emergency medicine critical care. Dermatology. Come on. I think every rash you can put Lotrizone on and it'll go away. And just so you guys know, every time I say that at conferences, the dermatology PAs freak out a little bit. They hate that I say that. But bottom line is that's my world, right? So guess what? They're saying if you want to optimize this score, I want you to look at musculoskeletal derm. Okay? Now, here's my actual board scores. So, 13 categories. This content blueprint is a fixed number. So cardiac is 16%, pulmonary is 12%. Fine. Here's the percent I got right. So cardiovascular, I got 84% of all my cards questions right. I was in the top 20 percentile. Hey, good job, John. Pulmonary, you got 92% of your palm questions right. You're a freaking rock star. Guys, it's very predictable. Here's the deal. For those of you who are going to take your boards, take your pretest. If you're in the green, you're ready. If you're yellow-green, you're probably ready. If you're yellow, yellow-red, or red, do not take your boards. You will fail your boards. That's based on dealing with hundreds of students who've shown me their grades. I've only had one exception to that rule. I had one person who was way in the green, and they tanked their boards. It made no sense to me. I have no idea what happened there. So I don't want to say it's 100%, but I'll say it's 99%. Okay? Now, if you don't take your pretests and find yourself in the green before you walk in on test day, just don't whine to me about you failing, okay? You have the tools to know where you're weak. Guys, so what you do is you take your pretest and then you isolate the fact that you're weak in musculoskeletal and derm. And then you know what you do? You are laser focused in your studies, musculoskeletal and derm. That's your job. You fix that problem. And then you know what you do when you go, wait a second, I feel pretty good about it now. Guess what you do when you go, wait, I conquered that. What do you think you do? Take another pretest. Take a different one and see how your deficit was minimized. And guys, if you're not sure how to proceed, call me and send me a picture. I get them all the time. 3, 4, 5 times a week, people send me pictures of their pretest scores. John, what do you think? I'm like, oh, okay, you're fine. You're not fine. You better study this. Now, it is the secret weapon to pass your boards. It's absolutely valid. And if you don't do it, I wonder why people don't do it. Because people don't do it. Is it lazy? I think it's fear. Because they don't want to see how bad they are. But then they get a failing test grade and it's like, your life is going to be pretty miserable for the next 6 months if you fail your boards. And some people are devastated by failing their boards. And some people don't ever recover from it. Okay? It takes a lot of courage to go sit for the boards a second or a third time because you failed it. It's a very difficult conversation to have with your parents, your boyfriend, girlfriend, husband, and wife that you just dedicated 2 years of your time and you failed your boards. Okay? It is unbelievably painful when I have people call me and they have that quiver in their voice. I just got my scores and I failed it by 5 points. okay? Very few people fail their boards by 30, 40, 50, 60 points. People typically fail them by a football score, 14 points, 7 points, 3 points. You can't fail your boards, okay? I'm giving you the tools. You just have to use the tools. There's a sign at one of the gyms in Buffalo that says, if at first you don't succeed, try doing what we said to do in the first place. I will give you the tools, but it's got to start with this pretest. You got to know where you stand. The senior students, you know who've coasted. If you've coasted your senior year, went to rotations but didn't put the time in, you know who you are, okay? You're in trouble. You're probably in trouble. If you said, I'll just get the studying in at the end, you're probably going to be in trouble. Okay, junior students, don't put yourself in that position. Your studying for the board starts today. So when you get your pack rat, you're a 160s, 170s pack rat. You're not even close to failing. Okay, take really good notes in this course. Here's my deal, guys. Research shows that verbatim mindless note-taking is no bueno. Wait a second. Let me ask you a question. Why am I doing that? Why am I putting the font yellow? So that's harder to see. Why did I make it an angle? I even threw some Spanish in there. So wait. So guys, if I said read the red writing, you read that without any effort at all. If I said read the yellow writing, guess what? It increases your effort level. You have to work harder to read that. The deal is, guys, you guys are adults and you guys are here. You know your own note-taking strategy. When you look at literature, studies, psychological literature of learning, people who have a blank notebook and take really good notes in my course, the recall goes up 50% as opposed to just doing this. I'm not here telling you guys how to do what you do. I'm telling you, you want to get the most out of my course, I want you to take really good handwritten notes that will optimize the learning. Okay? We will take a break before we get into content. If you are a struggling student and you know who you are, I need you to go get a pad of paper at the break or go get 20 pieces of typing paper and get ready to take really good notes. That's how you will optimize my teaching strategy. The breakdown of the boards. Understand that if you look at the breakdown of the boards, cardiac, pulmonary, GI, musculoskeletal is 48% of your boards. So guess what? Half of your boards are four topics. So I was talking to some people before the course, and two different people said, I hate endocrine. I don't like endocrine. Well, guess what? Endocrine is at 6% of your boards. You can be fine if you hate endocrine as long as you know diabetes and thyroid. But you gotta love cardiac. You gotta love it. You gotta love pulmonary. Okay, and I'm gonna give you one hack right now. They say infectious disease is only 3% of the boards. It ain't 3%. It's a massive, massive, massive topic. What do you mean by that, John? That's probably gonna be the biggest topic on the boards. What do you mean by that, John? I'm saying that if I said meningitis, that's infectious disease, correct? No, it's not. According to the blueprint, that falls under neurology. Pneumonia, that's infectious disease. No, that's pulmonary. Otitis media, that's infectious. No, it's ENT. If you look right here, ladies and gentlemen, right across the top, these are 13 categories. If you count up every box, it equals 551. If it's the color yellow, it's infectious disease. I know how important it is, so guess what? The second lecture that I'm going to give in this course is going to be infectious disease. You're going to know your bugs and drugs. You have to. It's a massive part of the boards. Ladies and gentlemen, how I'm going to teach you, I'll teach you ways to make concepts pop. The infectious disease portion, I don't think anybody on the planet can teach it the way I'm going to teach it. I'm just telling you, I'm going to make it so easy for you, you have to know my system of infectious disease like the back of your hand, okay? It's going to give you a lot of right answers. Now, we're going to do some audience response unit questions. Here's the deal. The audience response units are anonymous. I'm not going to put anybody in the spot by calling on them with the audience response units, but I want to ask you this question right now. If you took your boards tomorrow, and I don't care if you're a junior or senior student, but if you took your boards tomorrow, here's my question. How sure are you that you'd pass? Ready? Go. Just answer honestly. I got 37 respondents, 38 respondents, thank you. 39, 40. Let's see where you guys responded. Okay. This is kind of tough because we have juniors and seniors mixed together. It's tough to get a really good feel, but it's honest, okay? And I dig, you gotta be honest. You gotta be honest about where you are right now. It's always interesting because what we used to do is track people's perception before and after the course. And there were times we'd have people who signed in as a 9, and then when at the end of the course, we said, well, how do you think you are if you're going to, like, what's your number? They went to a 7. And I'm like, wait a second. You went from a 9 to a 7? And then the question was asked, we made you dumber? And then when we finally tracked these people down, they said, no, you showed me that I don't know as much as I think. Okay, well, there's a blessing there, okay? So let's see right now how well you are so you can test yourself, okay? Thank you for listening to this podcast by Seeming for Life. If you want deeper content engagement, consider our video on demand series. Consider coming to one of our immersive environments. That's one of our Board of View courses. Look at our testimonials online. It's engaging, it's fun, it's transformative. It makes you learn what you've been missing. And consider our alternative study Panbury resource, where it's a book that allows you to study at the depth you need to know exactly for the alternative Panbury. We took the guesswork out of it. Good luck in preparing for your boards.